But it's undoubtedly the case that everyone in this sanctuary has had experiences where you have been dressed down, perhaps in public, criticized, condemned, blamed for something that, well, you didn't really do, or they got it wrong a little bit. And if it's been a while since that's happened, perhaps with the benefit of some distance, you have enough self-awareness to recognize that, well, maybe in fact you did deserve some of that blame that you had so instantly tried to get rid of, pass on to someone else. Sidney Harris, who is a journalist for a number of the Chicago newspapers in the 20th century, famous for many of his aphorisms, once said this, "What people say about us is never quite true, but it is also never quite false either. They always miss the bullseye, but they rarely fail to hit the target." They always miss the bullseye, and that's what allows us all the room for explanations, clarifications, and self-justifications. So we're not really to blame. But they rarely miss the target, and so, in fact, that's why it hurts. If they criticize you for something that, well, just is completely not the case, you know, that Hugenberger, he wastes all his time watching ESPN, you know, he's like a sports addict. If you criticize me that way, it doesn't faze me because, well, as my sons could tell you, most of the time they're protecting me from any sports illustration that I use in a sermon, talking about how the Patriots almost got a home run. And that kind of thing. You know, if there's not an ounce of truth, it doesn't hurt. It's because there is so much truth hidden in among the misunderstandings and misinterpretations that it is utterly painful. But for the moment, in order for you to identify with our text, just think about a case where you were criticized, where you were blamed, where you were condemned, where you're very sure you really didn't deserve it. It didn't happen. It wasn't that way. They got it wrong. And then your situation will be a little closer to that which was portrayed in our Park Street Films video with Henry receiving that tongue lashing from Clay. How are we supposed to respond to criticisms like that? That's the main point of the sermon. And that is perhaps the most powerful takeaway from David's example for us as set in this text. The background is, as I say, a broken relationship with David's oldest living son, Absalom. Absalom, in his frustration, has now mounted an attempt, a coup d'etat, and already leading a large group on the order of multiple thousands of those who are his loyalists coming into Jerusalem as David gets word, and David says to his officials who were with him in Jerusalem, "Come, we must flee, or none of us will escape from Absalom. We must leave immediately, or he will move quickly to overtake us and bring ruin upon us and put the city to the sword." David and his loyalists are running for their lives to the east, to cross the Jordan, to get into the Transjordan area around the river Jabbok, where they're going to find some protection. And on their way, starting from the mid part of chapter 15, the chapter earlier than our text, until right now, we have a series of five encounters that David has during this exodus. And we've now come to the last of them, where he meets up with this man, Shimei. The earliest of them were very encouraging. The latter, last two, well, fourth one questionable, and the fifth one utterly heartbreaking and distressing. Who's Shimei? Well, it turns out that he is someone who comes from Bahurim, which is the first village on the east downward slope of the Mount of Olives. They've just left Jerusalem, gone down the Kidron Valley, and now are up. Remember David weeping as he goes in anticipation of David's greater son and his wheel dolorosa, his path of sorrows as he goes up the Mount of Olives and is in such terrible grief. As David goes up, he also has an experience where he says, "Not my will, but your will be done," when he invites the Ark of God to go and return to the city of Jerusalem. He won't presume on his innocence. He leaves his case with God. And now, on the other side, the east side, as they continue on toward Jericho and eventually across the Jordan, here comes Shimei. But he's from the town of Bahurim, which is a Benjamite city. He's from the tribe of Benjamin rather than David's tribe, the tribe of Judah. David had located the capital of the city in Jerusalem precisely because it's right on the boundary between Benjamin and Judah to represent the unification of all God's people under his rule as the Lord's anointed. But now we're in the first village that's all Benjamite, and Shimei is a representative of that tribe and a member of the very same clan as David's predecessor Saul. Well, now we see that the unification was at least somewhat questionable. There were many elements in it, those who were still fans of Saul who are yet to be totally integrated, and it all comes out in this explosion, this volcano of verbal abuse. What does Shimei do? He curses David. And in fact, 8 times in 10 verses, the word curse is used. I don't know if you noticed it. It's constantly repeated, starting with verse 5, as King David approached Bahurim, a man from the same clan as Saul's family came out from there, and his name was Shimei, son of Gera, and he cursed as he came out. You may have been the recipient of curses of one kind or another, blasphemies, instructions to go to hell, and so on, but often spoken by those who have no idea what they're talking about. This man actually was cursing by the living God, and the implications of that for those who actually believe is, of course, devastating, reviling, running him down, and cursing him. Along with the curses, it turns out Shimei wanted a visual aid, and he didn't have Park Street Films to help him. Instead, he uses a little visual aid of kind of acting out what he thinks David deserves. He starts throwing stones at David. Now, he's not slinging them. This is not actually dangerous to David in terms of bodily harm, although I suppose if you got beamed with one of them, it might be. But that's not the point. The point is to symbolize the capital punishment that you deserve, David. You deserve not only what Absalom has done, you deserve far worse. You deserve to be executed because you stole the throne through a series of murders. You're a man of blood. And you are, well, he uses this term that is in our Bible translated scoundrel. It's the worst negative derogatory term you can use in Hebrew. In the old Bibles, it would be translated son of Belial. And in the book of 2 Corinthians, Paul shows that by the New Testament times, Belial is used for a name for the evil one. In any case, you're either a worthless good-for-nothing, or you are a hell-bent scoundrel, something like that. The word can be understood in a variety of ways, but it's clearly not flattery. And you have it coming. You have it coming. 3 times over, Shimei says, "The Lord has repaid you for all the blood you shed in the household of Saul, in whose place you have reigned. The Lord has handed the kingdom over to your son Absalom." You see, this is a man who is a true believer and believes that God has bringing his retributive justice to bear on David. He's getting what he deserves. You've come to ruin because you are a man of blood. You deserve it. Now, in fact, as Sidney Harris points out, there's always this missing of the bullseye. It's not exactly as Shimei understands it all. He's got the facts twisted in important ways that David could easily comfort himself with. He accuses David of coming to the throne through a series of murders, presumably starting with Saul himself. But in every case, he's got it a little off. David, of course, didn't murder Saul. It's true, David was a vassal of the Philistine king Achish at the time. Saul had been trying to kill David. David had escaped into the Philistine territory in order to preserve his life. But he never ceased to be loyal to Saul as the Lord's anointed. And though he was a vassal of King Achish, he was not there in the battle on Mount Gilboa where the Philistines defeated the Israelites and where Saul was wounded and then took his own life. In fact, David had plenty of opportunities to kill Saul. It looks convenient that Saul died because that was a prerequisite for David coming to the throne. But it's not a murder he arranged or had any part of, or a death that he had any part of. He wasn't there. In fact, he was 100 miles away back at Ziklag. The Philistine generals didn't want him in the battle because they knew that he would probably be a turncoat. And in the midst of battle, pretending to be an ally of the Philistines, he would then turn against them and actually win the battle for the Israelites. We know that David did not welcome news about Saul's death. 2 Samuel chapter 1 begins with this remarkable, moving eulogy for Saul that truly is heartfelt. And when the Amalekite who brought the crown from Saul's head and the armlets of royal authority from Saul's arm, when they came into David's possession, it wasn't because David was at the battle and killing Saul. They were because a man, an Amalekite, took them and brought them to Saul. And when the Amalekite pretended to and wanted to take credit for killing Saul, making the way for David to come into the throne, David ordered his execution. By what right? How could he possibly have lifted a hand against the Lord's anointed? The Amalekite was self-condemned by his boast, by which he hoped to ingratiate himself with David. In any case, in every other respect, likewise, Shimei has it wrong. If he thinks, no, well, it's not David, it was Jonathan you killed. Well, clearly that wasn't the case either. David wasn't there when Jonathan died. It was in the same battle, and David loved Jonathan. And in fact, Jonathan's expectation was that if he lived, David would be king and Jonathan would be second. Jonathan, though Saul's son, though the prince, the heir to the throne himself, abdicated the throne to David. And he says so and recognizes this back in 1 Samuel. If you think it's Ish-bosheth, Shimei, David killed the remaining living son of Saul, Ish-bosheth. Once again, David did not, and it was his officers that did so. And when the officers brought evidence of Ish-bosheth's death, decapitating him and bringing his head to David and thinking that would get them in with his good graces, David's response was to order their execution and give a respectful burial to the decapitated head of Ish-bosheth. Well, so yeah, there's a lot of blood there, but it was all spilt by someone else. What was the problem? How was it to be resolved? Well, Abishai comes to the rescue. Abishai is one of David's generals. Shimei is hurling imprecations against David, throwing stones, heaving dirt upon David and his men in a kind of a little prefigurement of his death. The word for dirt there is the same word as dust. From dust you are, to dust you'll return. So the dirt is getting thrown on him as if he's burying him, because that's what Shimei thinks is going to happen. Abishai, the loyal general of David, says, "Why should this dead dog curse my lord the king? Let me go over and cut off his head." Maybe when you were getting dressed down there at the office, you wished that someone would speak up for you and take care of it. Well, Abishai has a solution. He's observed that when people are decapitated, they don't curse anymore. And so he figures, well, that's an easy solution. He's a military man, a man of action. But of course, Abishai is exactly an example of what is so wrong and difficult about these sons of Zeruiah, as David points out. They're always quick to draw the sword. The book of Proverbs says, do not envy a violent man or choose any of his ways. They always want to deal with things by, you know, using a bigger stick and responding in kind. There are a lot of people who think that this is somehow or other a feature that religion tends to bring out of us, those who are trying to analyze what happened with this massacre in Orlando a week ago, the deadliest mass shooting by a single gunman in American history, as it's been called, or the largest targeted mass killing of LGBT people in the Western world since the Holocaust. It is a dreadful thing that happened. And the assumption is, well, maybe the big factor here, it must be religion, because the perpetrator, of course, is giving credit, he thinks, to ISIS as he explains what he did. And that fits into a kind of a narrative that people have about religion. And actually, you know, there's an element of truth in it. Blaise Pascal, the great 17th century Christian philosopher and mathematician, he said, men never commit evil so fully and joyfully as when they do it for religious convictions. This is Pascal, one of the great defenders of the faith, deeply insightful follower of Christ, recognizing that there is this problem. And writing in the next generation after Pascal, Jonathan Swift, the English essayist, likewise, remember this is on the other side of the 30 years war of Protestants and Catholics killing each other for a lot of it political reasons more than religious, but nevertheless, Jonathan Swift said, we have just enough religion to make us hate, but not enough to make us love one another. It seems like Abishai has got enough to make him hate and to motivate him to more urgent slaughter of his enemies, but not enough to make us love one another. But the problem is not that we don't have enough, that we have religion, but we don't have enough, according to Swift, and certainly not enough of the religion of Jesus of Nazareth. In the Sermon on the Mount, he said, you've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Love your neighbor coming from Leviticus 19 and hate your enemy coming from nowhere but someone's head. Nowhere in the Old Testament. You're to instead do good to your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. You want to honor Father's Day in the way it ought to be honored? Be like your Father in heaven. Love your enemy. Don't respond in kind. Don't try to overcome evil with evil, but rather to overcome evil with good. Well, how does David respond in fact? Well, I'd say this is exactly what he does. First, he argues against the advice of Abishai, and the king said, what do you and I have in common, you sons of Zeruiah? If he's cursing because the Lord said to him, curse David, who can then ask, why do you do this? Don't be so quick to respond, David says, when you're being cursed. Ecclesiastes 7 says, don't pay attention to every word people say, or you may hear your servant cursing you. For you know in your heart that many times you yourself have cursed others. You know, recognize our capacity for allowing our mouths to get carried away and say things that, well, Proverbs 12 says, a fool shows his annoyance at once, but a prudent man overlooks an insult. Proverbs 20 says, it's to a man's honor to avoid strife. Don't get into this idea that, you know, it's macho to want a good fight, verbal or otherwise, you know, to stick up for your rights. No, it's macho to avoid strife, but every fool is quick to quarrel. We rush into arguments. Who's to blame? David would be particularly keen on this because he knows how man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. God said that to Samuel when Samuel wanted to pick David's oldest brother as the Lord's anointed, when in fact it was the least promising of the sons of Jesse that God had in mind, the youngest of them, the youngest of eight, the one that even his dad didn't think needed to be brought to the occasion. That's what his father thought. David's own father thought, well, if we're looking for future kings or if we're having an important celebration, David can stay at home. But man looks at the outward appearance. The Lord looks at the heart. We who don't have that X-ray of vision, we should be very reticent to respond. He who answers before listening, that is his folly and his shame, Proverbs 18. Do you start getting your answer out before you've even heard the other person? Do you jump to conclusions? The first to present his case seems right till another comes forward and questions him, Proverbs 18 says. You know, all you've heard is what you thought was the answer, the final response. But my dear brothers, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. Abishai's got it wrong. If we have real religion, we're going to take it easy and respond slowly, slow to become angry, slow to speak. Secondly, not only is there that reserve that David shows, but there's proportionality. You know, we often take out on others a problem that has nothing to do with them. My son, who is of my own flesh, is trying to take my life. How much more than this Benjamite? The problem is not Shimei. The problem is Absalom. Absalom has broken David's heart. And it would be so tempting to respond in a kind of turn up the volume sort of way with Shimei's cursing. I actually had an example of this while I was thinking about the sermon last week at our elders' meeting when I spoke sharply to someone. And I realized afterward we had an exchange on emails, and I apologized because it really had nothing to do with him. I was very grumpy about something else. Does that happen to you? You know, you got this other background issue. The real problem is something else. And then you let loose on whoever, well, you come home and kick the dog or whatever, you know. My own son is against me. It's hardly surprising that Shimei, who is of the same tribe as Saul, would be against me. David had a profound love for Absalom. He loved him so much that when he was in his self-imposed exile, David mourned for his son every day, 2 Samuel 13. The spirit of the king longed to go out to Absalom, for he was consoled concerning Amnon's death. He loved Absalom. When later on David's men were on the run and finally gathered themselves at the forest of Ephraim in the Transjordan area, where the two armies then came together, David tells his generals, be kind to Absalom. Be gentle with the young man for my sake. This is in the middle of a war. And when they, in fact, take Absalom's life, as was actually appropriate, and word comes back to the king, he says, oh, my son Absalom, my son Absalom, if only I had died instead of you, oh, Absalom, my son, my son. There's not a parent who wouldn't prefer to die before their child. I mean, it's just built into us. David's concern for Absalom, even though he deserved to be killed for raising a rebellion and a civil war, for the father's heart of love, you would rather it have been you. Not only that, but David responds not only with this proportionality, realizing what the real problem is, he has the ability to look and see God's hand in this encounter with Shimei. He says, if he's cursing because the Lord said to him, curse David, who can ask, why do you do this? Our lives are not just a series of coincidences and accidents that are all meaningless. Everything is coming by the hand of God. What do you understand by the providence of God, the almighty and ever-present power of God, whereby he still upholds, as it were, by his own hand, heaven and earth together with all creatures, and rules in such a way that leaves and grass, rain and drought, fruitful and unfruitful years, food and drink, health and sickness, riches and poverty, and everything else, including that person who's yelling at you, all of it comes to us not by chance, but by his fatherly hand. This is right from the Heidelberg Catechism, question number 27. And 28 says, what advantage comes from acknowledging God's creation and providence? We learn that we are to be patient in adversity, grateful in the midst of blessing, to trust our faithful God and Father for the future, assured that no creature shall separate us from his love, since all creatures are so completely in his hand that without his will they cannot even move. It's the recognition that God is in charge. What people say about us is never quite true, but it's never quite false either. They always miss the bullseye, but they rarely fail to hit the target. Shimei, although he didn't know it, was actually speaking the truth. That's what was so hurtful. Yes, God is causing these things, this rebellion. You have, in fact, come to ruin because you are a man of blood. But it's not the blood of Saul. That's where Shimei was wrong. It was the blood of Uriah the Hittite, the husband of Bathsheba, with whom David had had an illicit relationship. It's that blood that is being judged in God's providence, though misexplained, misinterpreted by Shimei, and David takes it to heart. It is an interesting thing that often it is the case that we are in that kind of situation, as Henry explains in our film. That I often think of my mother, who had an excessive belief in corporal punishment. There was very little evidence it was working based on us seven kids. But nevertheless, she continued it, and I remember a number of the incidents, but particularly one always stands out in my mind. And it was the one day that she managed to spank me and deal with me in a very physical way for something I didn't do. Every other time she got it right, I'll admit it. But this one I didn't. And I apparently was in the custom of always denying it, but there's something about my sincerity on this occasion that made her realize she probably was wrong. I wish I could have learned exactly how to word it that way for the future occasions that I would need it. But anyway, apparently it convinced her. And so then she said this, well, Gordon, if you didn't really do this, then just accept this punishment as the punishment you deserve for all the things I didn't catch you doing. And it just shut me down. I couldn't think of anything to say. I didn't have the temerity to claim that, no, you got every one of them, Mom. I mean, there were so many that she hadn't caught, including when I carved my brother's initials into his brand new dresser that Mom had bought for him. I had a hammer and a screwdriver, and I put Roy's name there. And who but Roy would ever have done that? I did finally confess that to him at a family party some years ago, and thankfully he doesn't even remember it. He had so many other spankings that one didn't, I don't know, anyway. Yeah, well, in the end, it's in God's hands if we believe in God. It may be the Lord will see my distress and repay me with good for the cursing I'm receiving today. You and I can show our trust in God by referring these problems to a higher court. You can play God if you want and get your own justice if you want, but you can also not do that. You can choose to love your enemy and to just leave these things in the hands of the Lord who is ruling over all of our lives. If someone, a slave even with respect to his master, is receiving punishment that is harsh, it's commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. How is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong or tongue lashing? But if you suffer that tongue lashing for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God, Peter writes in 1 Peter 2. Because to this you were called, Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. In our wonderful story today, we have the example of Henry knowing full well he didn't deserve this punishment. It was an accident. Angela, his administrative assistant, spilled coffee and rewrote it and turned an 18-inch into an 8-inch girder. But in fact, he did deserve far worse for having cheated his brother out of these plans. You and I are almost never getting what we deserve because we actually do deserve far worse. But it is a penalty that Christ paid for us in full on the cross. So we get it all. We get the proportionality that allows us to accept hardship as his fatherly discipline. And we get the assurance that there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus because he paid it all. Let it be so for us. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that we get to be able to return good for evil and to overcome evil with good. We pray, Lord, that instead of fighting back and arguing endlessly, that we would put our confidence in you who see all things, who are the Lord of our lives, the God of all truth and justice and mercy. We thank you for your fatherly care, you who know our frame and know that we are but dust. And we thank you that you always underpunish because you do not treat us as our sins deserve, but treat us only as what would be good for our amendment and correction. And we pray that we would always receive your fatherly discipline as such. In Christ's name we ask, amen.